We thank you for this time that we've gathered together, O Lord, to study your word. And we pray, O Lord, that you would open our minds, O Lord, and help us to have a deeper understanding, O Lord, of your will in our lives, Father, and your love for us. We pray, O Lord, for anyone that couldn't make it tonight, Father, that you would be with them, be with Brother Reuben and Sister Liliana, and Brother Greg and Sister Shelley as they travel. Keep them safe, Father. Watch over them as they come back, O Lord. We're just so thankful for all that you provide. We pray that you would be with us this evening, O Lord. And guide and direct us, O Lord, and direct our meeting tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, Brother Mike, God bless you.
Let me see if I can share my screen.
Can I ask a question real quick?
Sure.
Does anybody know how to do Apple Pay on Apple Play on an iPhone?
Yes, I do.
Can you share real quick?
If you swipe up from the bottom of your screen, it should pull up a little menu with AirPlay.
Oh, what does it look like?
TV with an arrow, rectangle with an arrow under it.
Rectangle with an arrow under it.
All right. Got it? Are you good?
No, I'm going to come in and ask you. I can't log on the computer. I was on and it bumped us off.
Well, bring the computer back in. I can do it.
Probably.
No, it won't log on. It just spins. Here.
Come on.
Sorry, everybody.
Hi, Elizabeth. Darlene, did I hear you say you were in Alabama?
Hi, yeah, Joe and I.
Yes.
We're still in Alabama because of the hurricane. We were going to go home, but we were afraid it would not be safe driving. So now we're going home.
Are you at Chelsea's?
Yeah, we're staying at Chelsea's.
Okay, tell her we said hello.
I sure will. Thanks, brother.
Little Chelsea sis.
Little sis.
You might have to go sit by Mike, Mom, because it's not.
All right. Are you ready to go, Donna?
Ready? We're ready.
Okay, go there. Put yourselves on mute. Okay, so apologies for the technical difficulties at the Pepe household. We've only got three computers and three phones, but we can't seem to get them to all the work. So, you got it, Donna? You good?
No.
All right. Well, come on in here. Just come on here.
Yeah, I'm going
to. All right, so we're going to, you know, there's lots of really interesting things that I wanted to talk about today, but the one thing that's been on my heart is just talking about the blood of Jesus Christ. And, you know, we use the phrase, there's power in the blood. We sing the song, there's power in the blood. We're going to go through the lyrics here in a bit. But, you know, what does that really mean? So I'd like to have a discussion today on that, or this evening on that. And I've got some verses and some thoughts to share with you, but hopefully I don't see a lot of red microphones with lines through them and people are contributing, okay? So let me get started here. So a couple of things to bring up first. You know, I always find this interesting that, you know, Jesus is always portrayed as a sheep going before the slaughter. Guiltless, which is all true, guiltless, kind of meek and quiet. He doesn't say anything in his defense, but yet inwardly, he was torn. You know, inwardly, you know, he was in anguish. This was a difficult decision, half man, half God, here on earth. And he's, you know, Peter tells him, oh no, you know, this is never going to happen to you. You're not going to die. We're going to make sure you don't die. And what does he say to Peter? He says, get behind me, Satan. You know, don't tempt me. Don't tempt me to not do what I'm supposed to do on one hand. And also, you don't understand the will of God. And the will of God that he was going to go to the cross and die for us. But when he had his disciples and he went up to the Mount of Olives to pray, he asked the Father that if it be his will to remove this cup, but nonetheless, your will be done. And an angel appeared to him to strengthen him. And it says that He was in agony and he prayed earnestly. Now that has to be really hard. And his sweat was as great drops of blood falling to the ground. And you know, there's actually a medical condition. Don't ask me the name of it. Maybe our doctor here, Tony, could tell us. There is a condition where if you're under so much stress and pressure and anguish that you can actually sweat blood. It's a known medical condition. So here's Jesus really contemplating and anguishing over what he has to go through, what he's going to go through, because he knows what it means. He knows the separation from God, and he's sweating blood. Now, this is just interesting. It's not the precious blood of Jesus that we're going to talk about, but before he went to the cross, he was really, really contemplating and thinking about and praying about what he was going to go through, what he was going to endure, and what that really meant physically as well as spiritually. And he sweat blood, says he sweat blood. And then as he died on the cross, he's on the cross, and you know, they went over to the two thieves, I guess, on them. And they actually broke their shins, I guess, to hasten their death. And they said that, what I read said that they would die in a couple of minutes because they would just suffocate. But Jesus, true to prophecy and what the prophets had predicted, you know, nothing was broken, not a bone was broken. And when they saw that he was already dead, the Roman soldier, you know, stuck a spear into his side, and out came blood and water. And, you know, John's the only one that records this. And he says, and he that saw it bear record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that it is true, that ye might believe. In other words, what I'm saying is definitely true. Blood and water came out of Jesus. Now, physically, that's entirely possible with the death that he had, but he just wanted to explain. So here's Jesus actually shedding blood on the cross. When we talk about he shed his blood for us, this is one instance where he shed his blood. Okay, the only instance where he shed his blood in the Bible. Now in the Book of Mormon, you know, when King Benjamin is addressing his people, you know, 120 something years before the birth of Christ, and an angel had come to him to kind of lay out the whole picture, a beautiful chapter, you know, it lays out the whole story of Jesus' life, and he's going to be, you know, his name, who he's going to be born to. And he says, he's going to suffer many temptations. He's going to suffer pain. He's going to be just like a human, except when he comes unto death, blood will come forth from every pore. So great will be his anguish for the wickedness and abominations of his people. Okay. So here he's also bleeding, but more from the pores, on the cross, right? So those are the only references to blood really in association with his death. And I guess you could think here that, you know, I could go, I don't know if this means he was on the cross when he, or if this actually pertains to this verse, that he actually sweat blood, such was his anguish and his prayer. But
I think it's more to Luke.
Okay.
The last, you know, before he's actually on the cross. I think that's what that is referring to.
I agree. That's actually what I wrote, but I didn't say it. So his anguish was severe. But the only time he actually shed blood, it was he had already died. And they pierced his side and his blood flowed, okay? But his blood has such significance in Christianity, I thought we should talk about, and we talk about the power in the blood and what it means and what is that power. I'd like to go through the song and then a couple of and some verses and have some discussion. Is that, any questions up to this point, comments? Nope. All right, so here's the song, There's Power in the Blood, and I'm gonna actually get Alan to sing a little song for us here. because she has a great voice. Can you guys see the verses?
Would you be free?
Pay attention to the
burden of sin. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood.
Got my hand.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Okay. He left out a verse. That's why he was the shortest version, but we get the drift. Okay, so take yourselves off of mute here for a minute because I want to get your input before we go forward. So based on this song, there's power in the blood, and you know, we do know a little bit about scripture, so we could maybe go beyond these verses. But based on what you see in the red, what would you say are some of what's in the power of the blood based on this song? Just based on this song. It doesn't have everything, in my opinion. We'll go through that. But what do you take from this in terms of what power is there in the blood for us? Comments?
Based specifically on the song, salvation.
Salvation.
Because you're free from the burden of sin, right?
You're free, salvation, and I like just the word freedom, free.
Yeah.
Right? I agree. What other power does the blood of Jesus have based on this song? What would you walk away with?
Blood paid the cost.
What was that, Brother Bill?
His blood paid the cost.
His blood, he paid the price. Would you say redemption?
Everlasting life. Everlasting life with those who believe and want to serve the Lord for the rest of their ability.
When I first went through the song, I wrote redemption, everlasting. I wrote victory, right? You're going to have victory. You said victory over death, but victory over Satan. Right? Victory over sin. You're not going to get.
No, well, what you just highlighted, it also implies that through the power of the blood, we can overcome the weakness of our flesh. That the things that would tempt us or cause us to sin or to be angry or other emotional parts of being in the flesh, through the power of the blood, God can help us overcome those things.
It says we're no longer slaves to Satan. We're slaves to Jesus, right? We become slaves to him. We're not slaves to our passions. Exactly right, brother. Anything in here about being clean?
Yeah, the blood sanctifies us. The blood actually cleans as opposed to covering, which is what the Old Testament sacrifices did. Christ's blood actually cleans us.
It's like, could you say purifies as well?
Well, for the time being, yes.
I like the way they said Calvary's tide. You know, there for those of us that grew up on the ocean or to spend time in the ocean, the tide's pretty powerful. It's pretty powerful in terms of what it can do in terms of smoothing out rocks, smoothing out glass, taking out stains, changing landscapes. So surely Calvary's tide could cleanse your sins and take them away and sanctify you. I wrote down sanctify as well and purify. Makes you whiter than snow. And I just like the sin stains. Your sin stains are lost. The power of the blood is they're gone. God doesn't remember them anymore, right? They're gone, never to be remembered again, as far as the east is from the west. That's the power of the blood. That's what I took away from this song. It's like, wow, there's a lot in here, but not everything's in here. You know, it's a song. It's not going to get into all the little nuances. It's going to give you a nice tune. And I just like the way they just talk about the wonder-working power, the wonderful power, and the precious blood of the Lamb. There's a lot in these verses here, brothers and sisters. And
yeah, we just studied the word remission versus atonement. And okay.
What did it say?
And you know, just like Brother Jerry said, you know, atonement was like a covering, kind of like a Band-Aid. And remission is from the Greek word aphesis, which means forgiveness, pardon, letting go as if they had never been committed. Not just covered, but forgotten. Just like Brother Jerry said.
But yet they refer to Christ's death as the atonement.
Yeah, he was the ultimate sacrificial atonement.
But it was more than that.
Yes.
But his death is the atonement.
Right.
He atoned for our death.
The final atonement.
He paid the price, right? Interesting. Okay, so, that's what I took away. I wrote all that down. I thought, okay, that's really good, but I've got probably another half hour to talk. So I thought we'd go through some scripture that kind of pulls these points together. And I tried to bucket them and put them together, and hopefully you agree with the buckets I put them in. Maybe I got some wrong, but I think really the purpose here is just to go through some interesting verses that kind of talk about the power of the blood. Like, if you talk about Jesus Christ, what does he mean for us? What can he do for us? But the blood specifically, what is the power in the blood? So let's kind of go through that. If there's any other comments before I go on? No? Okay. All right. I have a hard time seeing with all these pictures of everyone on there, so I printed out, sorry. So I wrote forgive and atone. Forgive and atone. And there. Forgive and atone. So let's go through this. I'm sorry, I can't see with the picture, so I'm just gonna, is that okay? Can you guys see that?
Yeah,
that's good.
Okay, so Ephesians chapter 1, you know, it talks about we have redemption through his blood and for the forgiveness of sins, right? According to the riches of his grace. So that's a pretty standard verse right there, a go-to verse. I liked 1 Peter 1 because it talks about how we're redeemed with incorruptible things, not silver and gold, not things from the earth, right? But by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, who was the Lamb without spot. And it says, and it kind of takes us away from, it says here, not from the vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers. You know, you're kind of breaking away from the things that your fathers taught you, right? And we're going to save you, and we're going to redeem you, we're going to move you forward. And in 1 Timothy, he kind of talks about how this new spirit of redemption, it's not a spirit of fear, but of power and love of a sound mind. So from that, I take, you know, you're redeemed and you're saved, but you're also changed in the process, right? I'm changed. I have a new spirit, and I'm not afraid anymore, right? We shouldn't be afraid. What do we have to be afraid of? But they just hurt the body. They can't hurt our soul. They can't take away Christ's love for us. And, you know, Matthew 1, it just says, you know, you're going to bring forth the Son, they're going to call him Jesus, they're going to save the people from his sins. And it's right there. It's pretty black and white. So redemption, salvation, I tried to put the word to in front of each one of my words instead of ing or ion at the end of them. But these were some verses around redemption and saving their people and giving them a different spirit. Okay. And then I also put forgiveness and atonement together. Maybe they don't go together, but you know, some of these verses you can use on multiple. But I like when, you know, when John the Baptist sees Christ coming at him, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." He just said it right there. He said, there he is. This person's going to forgive us of our sins and atone, right? Atone for our sins. And then in Hebrews, Christ who suffered once to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him, he shall appear the second time without sin unto salvation. So Christ didn't just die. Christ died for everybody, right? Christ died for everybody. In fact, in Messiah says that his blood atoned for the sins of people past, right? Who died before Christ, who didn't have the opportunity to hear the words of Christ, who died in their ignorance, who were at the time of Christ, and people in the future. Christ died for everybody, past, present, and future, for all their sins. Now, whether they redeem that or not, that's up to them, right? But their sins are forgiven if they just want to come and accept him by faith. Comments or questions? So I had redeem and save. We talked about those. I had forgive and atone. I think we talked about those. And then I kind of put purify, cleanse, and sanctify. Right? All together. And I liked 1 John 1 because it says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, meaning Jesus, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. So not, you know, we're cleansed from the sin, but we also are able to fellowship with each other because we have that spirit. And we're trying to accomplish and move towards the same goals. We have the same purpose, right? We may not have the same gifts, right? But we have the same purpose in life, right? We want to follow Christ and do good works in his name. In Revelations, so I asked Jerry and Joe what they thought about this verse, because I thought I knew, but I just want to verify. It says read Revelation chapter 7. That's really cool, so you can kind of see where this fits in. But those that came out of the great tribulation were seen having their robes washed and made white in the blood of the Lamb. So that tied exactly to the song. So I like that, and I wanted to include that in here. And in Hebrews 13, it talks about, it says, Jesus, that he might sanctify the people with his blood. And I never really, you know, Jerry, you brought it out, and I kind of thought of it, but I never really, you know, Jesus is sanctifying us. Right, when we accept him. So his blood is the beginning of our sanctification process. So he sanctifies us, and then we're able to come into the presence of God, and we'll talk about that. But I hadn't put it with his blood until I actually did this study. I just knew Jesus did it for me, but I didn't actually have this verse in the back of my mind. And then in Alma, it says that your garments have been cleansed. He's asking people these questions, right? Have your garments been cleansed and made white through the blood of Christ, who will come to redeem his people from their sins? So lots of verses around redemption, around being cleansed, around being sanctified. And I put purified because You know, it says you're, when you get baptized, I'm pure, right? I'm without sin. My sins have been forgiven. They've been forgotten. I've been cleansed. I've been washed clean by the blood. I think I'm as pure as I'm ever going to be from that point forward. I'm going to just kind of get dirty in the world again going forward, but hopefully I can keep with God and keep asking for forgiveness and just, right, keep that process going and keep myself pure as possible going through life. Any comments on that or questions?
To the last point you just made about purification and baptism, you know, it's absolutely true what you said about the fact that, you know, when you're baptized, you're as pure as you could possibly be. But what I do think, you know, we, maybe all of us, and certainly myself, what we kind of underestimate or appreciate, I think, at times, is God's willingness to forgive us just for asking, just by the asking, a sincere spirit of repentance. So what I'm saying is that tonight, if I truly repent of my sins, I can be as pure as the day I was baptized.
I agree.
And I think the truth is, we say it, but I'm not sure we totally believe it. And that's why sometimes people, and again, including, you know, church members, can't get past mistakes they've made because they still feel it's clinging to them. And again, maybe it is if they haven't really repented, but I think often it's the devil who's like whispering in our ear saying, you know, it's still there. It's still there. It's still there. And that's why even sometimes I hear about people wanting, you know, and sometimes the church they did was rebaptize people. And in our church even. And you really have to wonder if that's necessary, because so many other scriptures indicate God can forgive you of anything and everything by the mere asking with sincere repentance.
Sincere repentance and faith and belief. I agree.
Yes.
I agree. You're right. We really don't talk about it much, right? The religion I belonged to previously, you know, every week you would go in a little confessional and you had to confess everything you did to go get your sacrament. So it was part of your weekly activity. Right. If you can make it through a week without having to go to confession, then you were doing pretty good, I think. But I usually went. I didn't like it, but it made you think about, right? It made you search what was going on. And we need to get into, you know, our fast and prayers are a great opportunity to do that, right? That's when I do it. But I really need to spend more time doing it, I believe. Yes, Sister Darlene?
Yeah, you know, it's being raised in that same church, I think we're both familiar with. You know, the interesting thing about the Roman Catholic belief is that, you know, when I was raised in that faith, is that when we participated in the Eucharist, which is the body and blood of Christ, as a young age, I mean, were we second grade when we were confirmed, something like that, we were told transubstantiation, where the Catholics literally believe that the wine turns into the blood of Jesus and the bread is his body, that it is a literal transformation. It may not be visually and it may not be chemically, but spiritually they think of it as you are participating in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And so you would think, okay, that there was maybe a heightened sense of understanding of what you were partaking in. But the truth is, I didn't feel that way until I came to the Church of Jesus Christ, because I understood the symbolism of it all, that it's so much greater than even the literal interpretation of this, but this is my Savior whose blood was shed for me. Right. And that cleansed me and it atoned for my sins, and that it, because of this selfless act, like I now could be made whole and be made clean. That kind of theological concept was not stressed. And I can only speak from my own experience, Brother Mike, maybe until I came to this church. So even though it sounds so grave and so serious how it was presented in the Catholic faith, the gravity and the seriousness of it did not befall me until I understood my relationship with Jesus Christ. Not some entity on an image on a cross or on a mosaic, but a living, breathing Savior who made the sacrifice for me. That's what transformed me and my faith and how I view sacrament.
Sister, it was grave and it was serious and it was incorrect. So maybe that's why we didn't feel the same until we got here. It was wrong. It doesn't transform.
It's of course a theme here in the scriptures and the words that you've kind of pulled out to categorize these verses, that we are being cleansed or redeemed from sins. And so the Lord is taking us out of the situation that we were in of condemnation and sinfulness and wickedness and putting us into a redeemed state. But the word sanctify would also, along with cleansing, suggest a devotion or dedication to God. And so why are we getting cleansed, right? I mean, certainly a significant part of it is that we might be forgiven and saved, but also that we might actually be consecrated to the Lord, devoted to the Lord, as though we were putting on that white garment, like a wedding dress, you know, that we would become the bride of Christ. And so along with that, there's kind of an interesting question that you could really spend a lot of time thinking about. Where does this power come from? You know, and in one sense, the power of the blood comes from Christ being the perfect sacrifice. And so he did what no one else could do. You know, most of humanity's history was spent waiting for Christ, you know, 4,000 some years, right, for his coming. And he did something that no one else could do because he was a pure sacrifice. And so his power, in part, I think, came from the fact that Christ was the perfect lamb.
You know, the word sanctify here, brother, I take to mean as to make us holy so that we could be a good, you know, a bride, right, at that particular time. Not that we're sanctified throughout the rest. It's different from this process of sanctification. Although, yeah, I guess I'd have to dig the scripture a little bit more, but to your point, as we're going through our lives as Christians and we're, you know, working on our sanctification, right, and making ourselves more righteous, communion plays a big role in that process in supporting you, right, in supporting your spirit. It is food for your soul and food for your spirit. So I had a verse, I'd have to go dig it out in one of the back slides that kind of talks to that. It says, hold on, you guys can see all my notes, but it says like it was the true food. Here it is. If somebody wants to look it up. Unless you partake of the blood, you have no life in yourself. It's the true drink. It's the true food. And last Sunday, the verse I had was Jesus was the true light. So Jesus, his blood is the true drink, the true food, and he's the true light. Yeah, interesting. John 53 through 57. Maybe we could go there later. You know, also, I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. I thought this was interesting, something we don't talk about much either, that the blood of Christ was used to establish, the power of the blood was used to establish the new covenant, right? The new covenant. The old covenant was done away with. The new covenant was now based on access to God and forgiveness and love, right? Your sins being forgiven, because the old covenant couldn't do that. The sacrifices of bulls and goats and whatever else they sacrificed, sheep, doves, right? That couldn't do it. So there's a couple verses here, Jeremy, that, you know, it's like, where does that power come from? power, to me, the power comes from God, right? And it's a significant power. God, you know, gave it to Jesus and he can use it. But, you know, not only does it have the things we're talking about, it also established a whole new covenant with mankind, an everlasting covenant with mankind that would never die, that would never stop, that would continue on until the end of time. This is the new and everlasting covenant. We, you know, we say these words, but it was the blood of Jesus that was shed. It was his death that enabled this to come in to play. And in fact, he says it when he's in Luke 22. He says it in lots of other places too. He says, when he offered the cup to them, he said, this is the cup of the New Testament in my blood, which was shed for you. In other words, you need to drink of this blood and participate because you're now in the new covenant. Okay, and this is proof that you're going to be in that new covenant. And, you know, it was part of the Last Supper, which was part of that whole process, right? So there's lots of verses that talk about this blood being the new covenant and establishment of the new covenant. And in 1 Corinthians, it says the same thing, right? That when he supped, he said, take this cup. It is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. So not only just do it the first time, you're going to do it every time, and you're going to remember this new covenant that we established that's forever, that's going to give you the ability to access God and be forgiven, all the things we were just talking about.
Mike?
We don't talk about that a lot, but it's there.
Quick comment.
Yeah.
Mike, so partaking of the communion is not the actual covenant. It's a sacrament of the covenant. So theologically, a sacrament, it is an outward expression of our inward commitment. So the covenant is what Christ did. The communion then is the sacrament that we use to commemorate, continually remember that we are in covenant with Jesus. And that's why we do it so often, so that we never forget. It's constantly there as a remembrance of what Jesus did for us.
Can I also make a quick comment, I think, which goes along, I believe, with what Brother Jerry just said? You know, it's interesting, the phrase, especially to somebody who, let's say, wasn't a believer, doesn't understand the significance of what we're talking about. But literally, when you hear there's power in the blood, the implication is that the blood itself contains the power. And therefore, someone could think like when I take sacrament, there's like power in that wine, or there's power in the bread, there's power in the substance. But, unless someone disagrees with me, but the truth is, there's power because of what Jesus did, which resulted in him being sacrificed and the spilling of blood. But so the power is in the act of what he did. But the power is not actually in the blood itself. It's symbolic for the sacrifice that was made for all mankind.
I always say that the blood that we and the wine that we take and the bread that we take feeds our soul. It feeds my soul because I look at that and say, well, the Lord gave it to us freely. And if we take it with that type of love and that type of compassion, it feeds our soul so we can go on for another whole week. And you want to keep yourself right and you want to keep going. It gives you that energy. It's like a locomotive. It starts off real slow, slow, slow. And as it builds, it starts to move down the track. And that's how that I feel. The blood of the lamb and the wine that we take gets me going for a whole new week.
Right.
If I can just make a quick point too, in regards to Brother Joe's comment, we're just studying this now in Leviticus with the Caitlin's eating a snack. We're just studying this in Leviticus right now, and in chapter 17, verse 11, it says, this is talking about the sacrifices, right? Because they gave these sacrifices. And I think it's so profound because I think it truly does relate to Christ. It says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. So, like, the blood of Christ provided remission, which is, you know, that word that means forgotten, but it also provided, you know, the blood actually was the atonement. I don't know if that makes any sense, but.
No, that's, what was that, Leviticus what, 17?
Leviticus 17, 11.
No, I agree. I guess the point here was by Jesus shedding his blood, he equated that to the establishment of this new covenant. And you can go back into, I'm sure you can go back into Old Testament and dig out lots of verses about blood and forgiveness and establishing covenants and blood covenants and all that. So this is part of the establishment that he had to do this to establish this new covenant. He had to die. I mean, to me, the blood, you would think for how much we talk about the blood of Christ, it would be a lot more in scripture about blood and his death, but there's really not. Other than the spear going into him, you know, there's not a lot of blood being shed. I mean, they beat him with whips and he was bleeding. You know, they put thorns on his head and he bled. There's not a lot of that in the scripture, but yet there's a lot about what that blood signifies in scripture and what it means to us. So I just find that interesting. So you're right, Brother Joe, you could say that some magical properties and right, it's doing something amazing, but for a Christian, it signifies so much. It signifies so much. And has such meaning. How much he loved us. How much he loved us to be willing to die for us and separate himself from his Father on the cross. Okay, a couple more minutes. You know, the power of the blood also establishes this new life we talked about a little bit earlier. We talked about freedom. We talked about victory. And these are pretty common verses here where it says that if you're in Christ, you're a new creature. Old things are gone away and new and you know, all things are new. You're a new person, right? And all things are of God who hath reconciled us unto himself through Jesus Christ and has given unto us a ministry of reconciliation. To wit that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and hath committed us to the world. In other words, when we get reconciled, our sins went to Christ, not to us, right? And then we're supposed to take that message forward, the message of reconciliation, what Christ can do for you, and what your part is in this whole process. And then Romans 6, maybe not everybody, people struggle with this, but, you know, because Paul talks about our wretched man, but for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but you're under grace. But now being made free from sin and becoming servants of God, you have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life, right? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ. That's what the blood of Christ did for us, right? We became his servants, and now we have fruit that we could produce. We weren't producing any holy fruit before when we weren't with Christ, were we? We probably weren't doing anything holy in the eyes of God, I'm sure. Not much. We were dirty, and we were bound for hell. And now we're new, and we have a new life. We have freedom, and we have victory over death. That's what the blood of Christ, that's the power of the blood. And then I had some verses on access and reconciliation, just kind of to wrap up. But I love this Matthew 27, when Jesus died and he yielded up the ghost, and the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks rent. Meaning that separation, where only the high priest could go in and see God in the Holy of Holies, I think once a year. Right? That was taken away. We could have access anytime to God because of the death of Christ. And In fact, this verse. Yeah, Hebrews 10. This was interesting. I hadn't caught this before either. But it talks about how Jesus is the veil, kind of equates his flesh to the veil as well. And when he died, we were able to have access to God. It says, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Christ, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, right? So by his death, his flesh was kind of equated to the veil that was separated. And now we were able to enter into God's presence, right? And be washed pure. Okay. I had some other verses here, but yeah, you know, it's also, this one's kind of confusing. I won't go through it. Kind of supports what we were doing. But in terms of reconciliation, were we reconciled to God, but he also reconciled peoples, right? So in Ephesians chapter 2, he talks about reconciling the Jews and the Gentiles together to be able to become Christians. There's no more separation. It says, for he is our peace who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, Jews and Gentiles. So he reconciles people that had no access to God, didn't know anything about God, with people who are God's chosen people, and brings them all together and calls them his people. Access and reconciliation by the power of the blood of Christ. Okay? I don't know, unless there's any other final comments.
Can I say something?
Sure.
So, something that I'm seeing or feeling here is the fact that, and I think Brother Joe made some comments, and even Sister Darlene, but in my mind, if you actually have not been able to go through the steps of repentance and request baptism, etc., how can you even understand any of this? So, since many people are baptized when they're babies, they don't get to go through this step or to even understand what this even means. And so, you know, perhaps that when somebody is newly baptized, this might be a reason why it's difficult to understand that we can just call on our God. And we have, you know, through Christ, we have the ability to do all of this and believe all of this. So if you didn't have to prime yourself in the beginning by studying the word or even understanding that we had to come before God with an open heart, contrite spirit, and repent, this might be difficult to even trust in.
I agree,
sister.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, there's lots of scripture. If you're not a believer, you won't understand what's being said, right? Unless the Spirit reveals it to you and opens up your heart. I know we've talked about this in some other classes, right? And that seed gets put in there. You don't understand. You don't understand the ways of God. You won't understand. You think it's foolishness, right? So yes, if you're not baptized, if you don't have the Spirit of God with you, then you'd have a hard time understanding everything we talked about. In fact, you'd have a hard time understanding most things of God and the Bible. And I think Darlene has a great testimony to that. You know, I wanted to focus on the power of the blood, but clearly the gift of the Holy Spirit, right, that God, that we receive, the Comforter, is our access now to the wisdom of God, right? I think, sister, what you're talking about. If you want to understand, you need the Holy Spirit inside of you. Otherwise, this isn't going to make any sense to you. And other people around you to help explain things when you have questions. I don't think you could understand it without the Holy Spirit. I didn't put that in here because I wanted to focus on the blood of Christ, but clearly the death of Christ and accepting him and being baptized, there's a lot more we could talk about. And that's one of them. Right. That help? You were your voice was a little scratchy on the audio, so I think I captured everything you were talking about. Okay. So my intent today was to just talk through a little bit about the blood of Christ and what it really means when we talk about the power of the blood. What does that really mean? Because, you know, a lot of times we'll start, I find it, it was really hard to take some verses and just put them into certain buckets on certain slides, because some of them transcend multiple slides, right? And then when you start talking about Jesus and his life and his death, and you weave a story together. So to just focus on one, you know, take a subject that goes this way and say, I'm going to talk about the blood of Christ, right? It's a little bit difficult because it starts bleeding into other areas. But I wanted to finish on this verse. So hopefully I accomplished my goal today, which was, let's talk about the power of the blood. Let's understand what's in the song, but also let's talk about what's in scripture. So that was my goal for today. And I just want to finish on this verse in Hebrews that I came across that it just touched my heart. It says, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. And really what it's saying here is he's able to save them to the uttermost, which is the same as the utmost, meaning to the greatest possible extent, right? It's not like Christ is saving us to the utmost of his potential. He's not withholding anything from us. It's the greatest, it's the best, it's the biggest, it's the most he could give. There's nothing else outside. When he says he saves us, we're saved completely. There's everything in there, brothers and sisters. I want to thank God for that today. Because when we come to him, he's not holding anything back from us. There's no something for this person and something. Right? We're all saved the same. Then we have to walk with him and endure to the end, which is a whole nother topic. Okay, 8:27. I got done on time, Brother Jerry, 57 minutes. It's pretty good.
I'll put a little something extra in your paycheck this week.
I appreciate that.
I liked Sister Gina's comment. It's reminded me over the years, watching some young people grow up in the church, having these aha moments as they come to an understanding about something about Jesus Christ. The aha moment of, oh, he really did die for my sins. And, oh, all I have to do is ask for repentance and I'll be forgiven again. And there's this constant growth that goes on with some of these people who hang on to the rod of God with both hands. And as they keep coming, as they keep reading, keep studying, we've seen it over and over again, the growth that takes place and the fruit that is produced is just amazing to God's honor and glory. And it's a lifelong process. We never grasp it all right from day one. But when we rally around these new converts and we work with them and we, you know, love on them, all of this begins to make sense. My own personal opinion, Brother Mike, about why there's so little about blood in the New Testament, he covered it pretty well in the Old Testament, and they pretty much got it as Jews. They understood the concept, but I think more importantly, he wanted to establish his doctrine. He right. wanted to spend a lot of time, you know, noting what was really important to him. And his death wasn't that important. His resurrection was critical, but he knew he was going to be leaving in place a whole new covenant, as you pointed out. And he wanted to make sure that that was set up and his church was set up so that we could carry it forward from generation to generation, you know, into the final end. The whole point is to prepare a bride for his return. Right. And we want to be that people. We want to take this seriously. We want to embrace it daily. And, you know, we beg people. And I know I'm preaching to the choir right here, but we beg people when it's communion time to make themselves right, because you are expected to be just as pure as the day you walked out of the waters when you reach into that plate every Sunday. There should be no excuse for that, because the forgiveness you were given the day you were baptized is available to you every day, like Brother Joe pointed out. And so let's continue to strive for at least that level of righteousness, and to encourage our brothers and sisters to take advantage of the love and the forgiveness that is so freely given as we go through our walk with Christ every day. Amen. Good class, Brother Mike. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah. So as Sister Julie mentioned in her prayer, there's a good group of people that are traveling out west. Let's continue to remember them, that they would return home safely, that their time there would be well spent. Brother Ruben, Sister Liliana, Brother Greg, Sister Shelley, I understand Sister Mary and Sister Kiara also went. The kids also went. So there's a little group that's traveling out west. So let's remember them in prayer and for a safe return home. Let's also remember Brother Joe and Sister Darlene, who are hopefully not fording any rivers, and they're going to find dry pavement all the way home. Let's pray that they get home safely, and we'll see them very soon. All right. We had a long, long prayer list on Sunday. Let's continue to remember those. Brother Bill?
Richard and Dean Batista are on the road, too. They're all headed west somewhere.
Yep. Yeah, I think they're headed to Denver this week. So they're going to be up seeing Walt and Carrie this week. So let's remember them in prayer as well. Any other prayer requests here tonight?
Yes. Keep Marco Sierra in prayer. He went home the other night. And just continue, you know, we ask that God continues to get him healthy.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Sister Ida.
Your mom, Sister Ida?
She's doing okay. She's starting to get pain. So we'll see how that goes. See.
All right. Very good. We heard some previews of the ladies' class for tomorrow night. Hopefully Sister Lynette didn't give away any spoilers. But for you sisters, I'm sure there's going to be a great class tomorrow night. Let me encourage you to join. And we will see everyone Sunday morning, 11 o'clock. All right? So may God bless each and every one of you. Brother Rich, nice to hear from you tonight. Why don't you go ahead and close us in prayer?
Okay. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we come unto you this time, Lord, and thank you for this class that we've been able to have here, Lord, and learn more about your word. And we're so thankful for the sacrifice that you made for us. That you, even as you were in the garden, and you sweat blood, as you took upon yourself that our sins, and as you sat, and you prayed, and you sat there, and you, all the things that would happen, that happened before you and happened after. And you could have stopped. You could have said, I'm not going to do it. But you did. And you went through with it. That we all might have an opportunity to come to you at any point, as has been said here tonight, and say, I'm sorry. I want to be better. And I pray that you would forgive me. And so, Father, we can't thank Jesus enough for what was done so many years ago, and for his resurrection and giving us the opportunity to eternal life. And Father, even as also has been said here tonight, we pray that every single time we take communion, we do it seriously, we do it worthily, that if there is anything that has caused us to, that would not be able to take it that way, that we would ask for forgiveness before him, that we would never upset you by not taking it worthily. Father, I pray that you would be with those that are in need. We've heard many here tonight. Those that are traveling, watch over them, protect them, Lord. Keep them safe from all things, whether they things that they know about and things that they may not know about, Father. We pray that you get them to their destination safe and sound and be with their families, Lord. Watch over us, keep us safe. Lead, guide, and direct us in all that we do. Talk to us, Father. Help us to listen when you speak. However it is that you speak to each of us, help us all that will listen, Lord. And we know that if we do these things and we follow your commandments, that we will be blessed. We love you and we thank you and we praise you. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Bye, brothers.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
God bless you, everybody.